is Steve from Trout Springs Winery and Branch River Trout Hatchery. We started our business back in 1985, where we originally had horses on the property. Then we discovered it had an artesian well. One thing led to another, and pretty soon, you know, 500,000 trout later, we're in the trout business. So we've been processing now since that time. When we built the winery, we built a commercial kitchen so we could process for area restaurants and private people. We raise about 30 to 50,000 brook trout every year. We're now looking at getting into Atlantic salmon. So hopefully by this fall we can do that. But you know, we're probably one of the oldest trout hatcheries right now in the state of Wisconsin. Way back when I was the kid, young kid on the block, now I'm the old guy. So time flies, you know, and but we've had a lot of successes over the years raising fish. And like I said, we process every Thursday night. We do boned, filleted, stuffed with sage and onion and crab meat product. And then it's always fresh. We never freeze any of the product, and that's the key to it all. People order on a Monday or Tuesday. We process Thursday, so it's fresh on Friday. We do restaurants. We do a lot of private people. A lot of it's just word of mouth. We don't advertise, and people find us. The location really picked us. We didn't realize that we had what we had here when we bought this place. We didn't not know that we had an artesian well on the property. And so I had always been interested in aquaculture, and so just decided, you know, when we saw the artesian well, let's do this. Let's start raising fish. The reason we do brook trout is that so many other people in the state raise, you know, rainbows. Rainbows are so domesticated, so easy to raise, that we want it to be unique in that sense. And it's a little harder to raise brook trout. We raise them to 3 years old. I think it's a little higher quality meat product. And we have great conversion rates. I think, like if you take the weight gain versus an animal like a cow, it's 10 to 1. Our fish are 1.1 to 1. So like I said earlier, it's an artesian well. Everything is going naturally. It's 30 gallons a minute. It's 50 degrees year round, never stops. There's no filtration. It's just natural. In the wintertime, the ponds actually steam because the water is warmer than the ambient air temperature. It's single flow through raceways. Everything flows through each raceway. Way back when, people said it couldn't be done. We proved them wrong. In 2012, we were the largest supplier of brook trout in the state of Wisconsin. So, you know, by you know, using proper techniques, flow through system, everything flows through, goes down into the aquifer, and generates itself right back up again. So it's kind of like a closed system in the sense that we don't draw off of a river or other ponds or any non-point possible pollution sources. So everything is contained right here on site. So we've got five different raceways that we raise different kinds of trout species in. Each raceway has a different year class of fish, and we typically start them from egg size from our own brood stock, and then at 3 years old is when we harvest, and then we do processing or stocking at that point. So on this raceway here, we've got some Atlantic salmon. These are year and a half old salmon. In the second raceway over here, we've got some 2 year old Atlantic salmon. These are nearing 2.5 pounds right now. Hopefully by this fall we can actually process. Back here, we've got some brook trout. These are 3 year old brookies, and typically we'll either process or stock ponds with them. We've got some Arctic char and larger brook trout right here. We use these for breed stock. And then on the last one, we've got about 20,000 I'd say they're probably close to a 6-month-old brook trout. So, and then we've got 13 other ponds in the back that we supplement these with. But these are the production ponds up front here. So everybody gets a different size feed. But I usually only feed once a day toward the evening. It's a little cooler then, especially in the summer months. And it's all done by hand. We buy it from, I think it's called Bio Oregon. We get it off the East Coast. It's a very high-end, expensive feed, but we think it's worth that because of the quality our fish are. So we don't use any pigmenters or chemicals, like I said before. It's all natural, vitamins A and D, soybean meal, fish meal. Very high in protein. We've gotten better, but when we first got them, they would not come up and feed like this. They'd wait until the feed got down to them. But now they've adapted to, I guess, our feeding schedule and habits, so how we do it. But they're totally unlike any of the other trout species that we have. So yeah, we're affected with the typical birds that everybody else is, the blue heron, the kingfishers, you know, that's a constant battle, so never ends. We also have swans that we have for weed control. Instead of using any chemicals here, we never do that. The most we ever put in these raceways is just farmer salt, and that dehydrates the algae. But we have swans for weed control on the larger ponds. What they do is they eat filamentous algae and cattail root. So it's a natural, sustainable way to continue without using chemicals. And these came from the University of Stevens Point at Bayfield, Northern Aquaculture Facility. They came in as small fish, and there were a lot of problems getting them acclimated. They were afraid of everything, you know, storms, get lightning, changes in temperature, rain. I mean, they're affected by a lot of stuff, whereas the brookies and the other fish are not. You can see the hatching trays in the back. We take all of our eggs and raise them in the hatching trays. Once they hatch out, it takes about 45, 50 days for them to hatch out. They go inside these tanks. We run water through these tanks. We have little vibratory feeders. They agitate the feed, drops in the water, and that's how they learn to feed. Once they're at about 2 inches, we move them outside into the raceways, and then they start their life cycle at that point. Usually it's pretty good. Once they get to this size here, they're off and running. You know, I never had formal education on aquaculture. But I network with many, many people in the industry. And so going all the way back to the Center for Great Lakes Studies in Milwaukee, back way back when we started working with whitefish and Fred Binkowski at that time. We've been at it for so long. You learn by your mistakes, certainly. I mean, I probably killed at least 50,000 fish in my time, that's fish farming. You know, there were times when we didn't have an automatic generator to back up the system, so that was another lesson, hard lesson learned to install that. Different devices. I did electrical work for 40 years in the industry, so it's pretty easy for me to do monitoring and that type of thing. I make a lot of my own stuff for that, so saves me a lot of money through the years. But you know, I don't know what else to say. It's just, you know, we're fortunate that we don't have any disease problems. Very rarely do we have that. When there is a problem, it's usually brought on by stress, which triggers a lot of things with fish. And so I think if you learn to have good water flow, good aeration, and your water's clean, I mean, you can raise fish. So our tasting room is in here. I do 30 different kinds of wines. Everything from sweet to dry. We have port wine. We have ice wine, red ice wine, which is pretty rare. And so something for everyone, okay? Our commercial kitchen is in here. We do all of our food prep and processing. We are actually a manufacturing facility, so we're held to higher standards than what most restaurants are. And so our gutting station is in the back when we process. There's procedures, we're HACCP trained, all that good stuff. So it takes a while to get to that point. So back here is our bottling area. We do all of our bottling of our wines. We check the wines at the station right here for the lab. But we process all of the wine in here. And so you can see the bottle fillers, 6-spout bottle filler, goes from there to the corker, and it comes down this station right here where we put the caps on. And then the labels are labeled with this little machine right here. You push a bottle in right here, and it rolls the label on very easily. So from there it goes into our case goods storage area. So back here we have wines that are ready to be bottled in bigger tanks and wines that are already done back here. So of course we had to add on to our area the last 2 years. We used to barrel age everything in here, and now we barrel age outside in what used to be the horse barn. So there's about 50 barrels out there that are aging all the red wines. So it's a process. It takes about 2 years to get from the grape into the bottle. So it's a bit of an investment, but well worth it. People come from all over the world, you know, and if they like the wine, they usually bring other people back with them. So that's the good thing. So we don't advertise heavily, but our product usually speaks for itself. So, but this is where the evisceration is done back here. And then the actual, because you have to separate, when you process, you have to separate where you eviscerate from the actual processing part. So all the evisceration is done back here, and then processing is done on the other side. And so that's where we do the bone filleted, stuffed with sage and onion and crab meat product. So I think the best part for me is producing a product that people love and they keep coming back for more. You know, fulfilling that need, I think they said, if you listen to the experts, the fisheries will probably be mostly depleted by 2050. And we need a lot more aquaculture facilities to fill that niche. And if young people don't do it, I don't know who's going to do it. So that's going to be the future. I guess if I had any advice to give to young people just starting out is take it slowly and just learn from other people, network with other people, and don't do more than what you feel comfortable doing at any given time, because you can lose it all in a heartbeat. And then you'll get disappointed, discouraged, and you'll throw in the towel. You know, like I said, I've been doing this since 1985. You know, so what is that, 36 years? It's a long time. But a lot of people have come and gone in that time too. So it's important, I think, to go slowly, not overspend. You can't afford everything right from the get-go. So you just do what you can. And you'll be fine.